Well, hello and welcome to church for June 7th, 2020. This week I spent a bit of time in the sanctuary praying, just trying to process everything that's going on in the world around us and everything that we're facing, and just felt like coming back to the sanctuary this morning for our time together. A couple of announcements as we get started this morning. First of all of our on-site services continue to be canceled at least until the end of June. And we have a committee that's a great group of people that are experienced in the medical field from all over the Quad Cities that are helping us make these decisions. We'll be sending out a survey most likely next week that will kind of ask your input on our reentry process and ask you some questions about some of the options that we're considering, seeing how many of you are ready to come back to the church services and how many of you would feel more comfortable worshiping online, so that we make sure that we've got enough seats for everyone as we approach this time. So in the meantime, we'll continue to meet online, either through Facebook or YouTube or church website or the church app, at 10:30 on Sunday mornings. And we'll also continue on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. During this time, the bills of the church continue to come in. So if you're able to give to that, then there are a number of ways that you can do so. You can do so through the church app. You can give through the church website by clicking on the donate tab. You can text to give by texting the word give with an amount to 563-334-0110. Or you can write a check and mail it. And we do check the mail here at the church every day. So if you are able to give, we greatly appreciate it. But if you're not able to give during this time, we understand that. We understand that many people have lost their jobs and are still in that waiting process. So please feel no pressure from us. A part of what I do every day is I spend time in prayer for our congregation. And I have, some of you have given me requests over the last year, and so I have those requests marked down in my prayer guide. If you have a specific request that you would like me to pray for, just send that to me. You can do that through the church app. You can do it via email. You can do it through a text message or a phone call. Let me know, but know that I do pray for you daily, and I do lift you up in the realities that you're facing on a daily basis. After our time in the Word this morning, we will follow this service with a time of pre-recorded music. And this morning we're going to be looking back actually at the last time we met together on March 15th for our time of worship. And so that's the worship service that we're going to watch after this video this morning. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as I stand in the sanctuary today alone, I'm reminded of all of the people who normally fill these pews. I'm thankful for the ways that you have kept us safe over the last 3 months. But I know that there is a lot of exhaustion, both physical and mental, as we process everything that's happening around us. Father, I pray for the division that we're experiencing in our country. I pray for the leadership of our country, both at a local level and at a national level, that you would give wisdom, that you would give insight, that you would help diffuse the frustration and allow us to focus on the issues that are at hand. And Father, I pray for those who are serving on the front lines as we continue in this fight against the coronavirus. I pray for those who are working in retail and in restaurants and those who are exposed on a regular basis to people from a variety of places. For those who are working in the medical community and those who are working a variety of other opportunities where they're exposed and concerned, I pray, Father, for your protection for them. And Father, I pray for those who are still trying to do their best to stay home. I know these are lonely days. I know that it gets very frustrating being alone and not being able to do what we're used to. And so I pray for your peace and your strength for these as well. Father, I pray that you would help us all to come out of this time stronger, more dependent upon you, more aware of our need of you and of what you want to do in our lives. And I pray that you would be with each one of us today as we watch this video. Surround us with your presence. Remind us of your promises to never leave us or forsake us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this morning I want us to take a breath as we work through our time in 2 Corinthians. Just a reminder that the book of 2 Corinthians was a book that was written under great stress. It was a part of a tearful interchange between the Apostle Paul and the church in Corinth. There was a disagreement that was taking place, and letters, quite honestly, aren't the best way to have hard conversations. But both Paul and the church in Corinth were trying to communicate back and forth and trying to connect with one another the best that they could across these letters so that they could communicate the heart of what they were experiencing. And just so you know, videos aren't the best way to process difficult conversations either. And I recognize the limitations of what I'm trying to do in preaching to a camera in an empty room and you watching it wherever you're at. I recognize that videos aren't any easier than letters to be able to process information, especially hard conversations. Many things in Paul's letters were taken wrong, specifically in this letter. Back and forth, the church in Corinth and Paul have written, and they have been frustrated with the fact that they weren't able to communicate what they wanted to communicate. Likely many things were miscommunicated from the Corinthians. Paul took things the wrong way as well. And as this letter is written, Paul is waiting on the other side for a response. He's anxiously waiting. He doesn't know how the church in Corinth is going to respond to the most recent letter that he's written, which was a tearful letter. And he's waiting to hear what they're going to say. And I'm sure it was a very anxious wait for Paul. I'm sure for Paul, as he was waiting first in Ephesus, and then he starts to move along the coast, along the route that the letter bearer would be taking, he's very anxious. He doesn't know how the people that he loves deeply are going to respond. Sometimes our best intentions come across wrong. And this certainly happened between Paul and the church in Corinth. And it certainly happens on a daily basis in our digital world today. We're not able to ask those follow-up questions and to probe a little bit deeper about what someone is saying. And that's a very, very painful reality of our attempts to communicate right now. So we must remember the heart. And Paul shares his heart at the beginning of chapter 2. And I think I just kind of skipped over this section when we went over it, just because it wasn't as applicable that week as it probably is this week. But I want us to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 2, starting with verse 1. "So I decided I would not bring you grief with another painful visit. For if I cause you grief, who will make me glad? Certainly not someone I have grieved. That is why I wrote to you as I did, so that when I do come, I won't be grieved by the very ones who ought to give me the greatest joy. Surely you know that my joy comes from your being joyful. So I wrote that letter in great anguish, with a troubled heart and many tears. I didn't want to grieve you, but I wanted to let you know how much love I have for you." We must remember the heart as we're trying to deal with the digital communication that we're facing today. The truth is that we're a very diverse group that normally gathers inside of this building. And there are a lot of opinions that exist between us, specifically political opinions. But our diversity is a celebration of the fact that we're a part of something bigger than just the world at large. We're a part of something bigger. We're a part of a kingdom that calls for people who have various opinions, who typically in the world don't get along, to be able to come together and to celebrate together what God is doing, who God is, and what He wants to do in our midst. So I'm going to say this for those of you that watched the video on Wednesday night. Some of you have given feedback that you thought it was okay, but it didn't go far enough, and some of you were deeply offended by what I said on Wednesday night. I recognize this place of tension as we strive to maintain unity in a world that is divided. So it is never my intention to offend. It is always my intention to pull us closer to Christ. And in the times when I fail to do that, I apologize. But please understand my heart, that we can so easily be caught up in the messages that the world is sending, and we fail to see the truth of who Jesus Christ is and the change that He wants to bring in each of our individual lives, and the change that He wants to bring in the way that we love one another. The truth is that all of us today are exhausted. 2020 has been tough. I was thinking today, as I was preparing for this sermon, you know, we started 2020 with a sermon series that said, hindsight is 2020. What will we look back on 2020 and wish we would have done differently? And I was thinking how differently I would approach that series now based on what we've experienced since January of 2020. One of my friends on Facebook shared a post from somebody that I don't know that I shared earlier this week that talked about just how traumatic this year has been for us. Political division has been at an all-time high with the impeachment trial that took place in January. And then we were struck by the COVID-19 pandemic, which has been extremely disruptive to all of life. And then we've had economic concerns that have come out of that as unemployment rates have been at the highest for years. And many people are struggling financially to make it in this world where they don't have the jobs. Many people lost large amounts of their retirement accounts in the stock market in the economic crash that followed. And racial tensions are higher than they've been at least since 1992, if not since the 60s. And we're exhausted. Now, these challenges are not new. We've faced all of these situations before as a nation, as a world. Nothing is new is happening. We've wrestled with these things before. In the 1900s, we faced the pandemic in 1918 to 1920. In the 1900s, we faced the impeachment trial of Bill Clinton in the 1990s. In the 1900s, we faced the economic challenges in the 20s and then again in the 80s. In the 1900s, we faced the racial tension, especially in the 1960s and then again in the 90s. And none of this is new, but this has never happened in a 5 or 6 month period. And it's the first time that most of us are living through these realities. And there's a tropical storm coming this week, in case your phone wasn't blowing up like mine is, that's going to send rain here to the Quad Cities, flooding rains, as they tell us. Oh yeah, don't forget the murder hornets that are somewhere in the U.S. This has been a tough year. And with so many things going on, it's really hard for us to keep paying attention to the things that are important. I think we can relate with the Apostle Paul. He's already shared in chapter 4 that he views himself as a fragile clay jar. And he continues this line of thought into chapter 5. And I want us to read along with what Paul has to say. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we will have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God Himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long to put on our new heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we will put on heavenly bodies, we will not be spirits without bodies. While we live in these earthly bodies, we groan and sigh. But it's not that we want to die and get rid of these bodies that clothe us. Rather, we will want to put on our new bodies so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by life. God Himself has prepared us for this, and as a guarantee, He has given us His Holy Spirit. So we are always confident, even though we know as long as we live in these bodies, we are not at home with the Lord, for we live by believing and not by seeing. Yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to please Him. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged. We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done. in this earthly body. Now, we looked at this passage on Wednesday, and quite honestly, my intention was that we were going to move past this passage. I had planned on looking at the next part of chapter 5, which is talking about being God's ambassadors. And we'll get there, it's just not today. There's more than one sermon in this passage. In fact, there's a couple more that I may come back to even on Wednesday night as we try to process the depth of what Paul is saying during this time. Paul is covering a lot of ground here, and that's a theme that will continue throughout chapter 5. As I was working earlier this week on outlining chapter 5, I put a note that says we're going to be here a while. There's so much good stuff that Paul says in chapter 5 that applies to us right now in this time of pandemic, in this time of tension, in this time of frustration and division. But a lot of what Paul says is that we're exhausted. Now, Paul was a tent maker. That was his trade. That was the way that he paid his bills. Some of the churches that he went to, the churches would provide a salary for him or money to live on. It wasn't a salary. But some of the places that Paul went, they didn't provide for him, and he had to work to pay for his own way as he was a part of the church fellowship. Corinth was one of those places where he said he never took a dime from them, that he worked hard alongside of them to accomplish the purposes of the gospel, but he didn't take any money from them. He made his money by making tents. Now, Paul's job of making tents was in high demand at Corinth at the time. There were things going on the worldwide scene where people were gathering in Corinth, and I've read it, and quite honestly, this week I could not find what I read. I think it was an Olympic-style game that was taking place during the time that Paul was in Corinth. And again, I can't remember exactly, but I think that's what it was. He had made tents while he was in Corinth, and the illustration that Paul is using here connected well with this audience. This concept of an old tent, they would understand what it meant when your tent was old, because tents were made out of leather, and when they got old, they leaked really bad. For us, we would probably refer to this as a car with too many miles. Our cars have gone too far. We know what it is when there's too many miles on the odometer. But regardless of the illustration that Paul was using or that we try to use today, the truth is we're exhausted. Paul said we grow weary in our present reality. We groan and sigh in our present reality. Things are overwhelming for us, and we're looking forward to a day that is coming. A day when we can rest with the Lord, and everything that is wrong with the world around us is made right. And all of the tears that we're shedding today are dried. And all of the injustice that we see in the world around us is gone. And all of the political division that we experience and that we see doesn't exist. That day is coming. It's not here yet. But while we are in the present time, we are weary. We groan and we sigh. And we're looking forward to that day. But Paul reminds the church in Corinth that we live by believing and not seeing. Now, this was the theme of what we looked at last week as well. In chapter 4, Paul tells us to fix our gaze on what is unseen instead of being so consumed with what we see around us. And yet I know for myself, on Sunday morning, those were the words that I put out on video. And on Sunday night, I, with the rest of the Quad Cities, was struggling with what I was seeing unfold in our own town. It's hard right now. It is hard to not fix our gaze on what we see. But I think there's great power in remembering the words that Paul spoke, that we need to fix our eyes on believing and not on what we're seeing. Paul reminds the church in Corinth of this very shortly after he said it. And quite honestly, I'm guessing that Paul struggled with this challenge as well. and so do the Corinthians. It's hard for us to keep our eyes on the eternal when the temporary that we see around us is so messed up. It's hard for us to keep focusing our attention on what God is wanting to do in us when we see and experience the pain all around us. I'm struggling with this. I know you're struggling with this. We're exhausted. We've experienced so much in such a short period of time. And any one of the things that we're experiencing, without any of the others, is exhausting and overwhelming. But when you put everything that we're experiencing as human beings together, it's absolutely overwhelming. Which is why we have to keep our eyes on what is unseen instead of just paying attention to what is temporary around us. This has been a tough year. And we're facing rough realities everywhere we look. What we've experienced in the last few weeks, what we've experienced in the last few months, what we've experienced as a nation has been so painful. And yet, looking ahead, it doesn't look any easier. Because this is election year. And everything politically that we're experiencing, all the angst and the frustration that we experience politically, is magnified in an election year. And the reality is that the economy is not going to recover quickly, and jobs aren't going to be immediately put back into place. I know as we plan for coming back into the church, it's not going to be the same as it was when we left in March. It's going to be different based on what we're hearing from the experts about not spreading this virus. It's tough. And racially, we have a long ways to go. We have heard the cries for justice. We hear that. And we've got a lot of things that we want to all do differently. We want things to be different in our world. But that's not an easy step to take because all of us have blind spots. All of us have things in us that cause us to respond to things that when we look back on it, we deeply regret what we said. Multiple stories have come out of the news this week alone where people in the heat of the moment said or did things that they deeply regretted later. We all have these blind spots that cause us to do things that we regret. And there is a call for all of us in this time to not ignore the cries for justice. Politically, it's not going to get any easier. For our health, COVID hasn't gone away. Financially, it's going to take some time to recover. And racially, we still have work to do. We're seeing it constantly. Oh yeah, and then there's the tropical storm that's coming in and the murder hornets. I want to challenge us this week. As I've been praying today, and I spent quite a bit of time in the sanctuary today being Saturday as I'm preparing, or recording this for Sunday. I spent quite a bit of time just praying about all that we're facing as a congregation, all that we're facing as a community, as a nation, as a world. And I just felt like God was saying, Emmanuel, you've got to take a breath. It's so easy for me with my personality. I get so driven when I'm seeing something that needs to change. And yet I feel like God has spoken to me and said, Emmanuel, you've got to take a breath. Take some time away from everything that you're experiencing. Take some time away from all of the painful stuff that you're feeling and everything that you see around you, everything that makes you angry in the world around you. Take a breath and spend some time focusing on me. Now, 2 years ago this week, I started my sabbatical. And I was gone for 6 weeks and on this sabbatical. The first 2 weeks of this, I spent in a cabin alone in Colorado, and I greatly appreciated that opportunity to just unwind a little bit. The conversation between Janelle and I leading into that experience was that every time we've taken vacation, I have been very angry and grumpy the first few days because my adrenaline levels were coming down and I have just lived on adrenaline my whole life. And so we decided that we would take 2 weeks for me to be by myself so that I didn't take that out on Janelle and the girls. And that was a powerful thing for me to experience, but it was deeply painful and deeply lonely, as many of us understand in these days. The first book that I read on my sabbatical, and actually I wouldn't let myself even finish unpacking in the cabin until I read this book, was a book on the adrenaline addiction. And talking about what it means for us to come down from the adrenaline that we live on, and really to not allow ourselves to get so caught up in the adrenaline going forward. And I've worked intentionally, and Janelle has worked intentionally, for us as a family to not live on adrenaline going forward the way that we were living on adrenaline at that time. Now, it's not easy, and especially over the last few months with everything crashing in around us. This last week especially, just feeling a sense of anger and frustration and adrenaline rush. And yet I felt like God today was calling me to step back from that adrenaline again. We don't sleep well when we're living on adrenaline. Our dreams are restless. Our sleep is restless. We're not creative when we're on adrenaline. We are irritable when we're on adrenaline. 2020 has been a huge adrenaline rush for all of us. And we're exhausted. So my question for us today, and what I feel like God is calling me to do, is to step back from the adrenaline for a few days. To step back from what I've been focusing my energy on. Janelle and I have been reading a book by Christopher Huertz called The Sacred Enneagram. And in this book, he tells the story of Mother Teresa. Now, Christopher was an activist and spent a lot of time working with human trafficking around the world, but spent time in India and worked with Mother Teresa and got to know her through his work. And as he processed who Mother Teresa was as a very driven person, very compassionate, but very driven, he noticed in her life that every day she intentionally took time to stop and let the adrenaline subside so that she could do what she needed to do. And he said this. He said, "As I watched her simple commitment to nurturing her own spirituality, it dawned on me that she didn't pray to support her work, but in fact, the work was the fruit of her prayers. She led with contemplative prayer, and goodness came forward. How did she do it? She took consistent sacred pauses to nurture an inner solitude, silence, and stillness." As I read that a couple of weeks ago, and this week, that just kept coming back to both Janelle and I as we were talking through what we're experiencing as a world. If we're going to be effective, as God wants us to be effective in bringing justice to situations, in bringing healing to situations, we have to take seriously our need to breathe and be humans. God created adrenaline, and we live with the ability to call on adrenaline at times when we need it. The danger is when we live on it constantly and we don't allow ourselves to come down from the adrenaline. So my question for us today is, can we take some time to believe? I don't know where your adrenaline source comes from. For me, adrenaline comes from media, social media or the news, reading stories online. That's where the adrenaline starts to pound in me these days. Can we slow down on our consumption of this adrenaline? Can we instead make sure that we're spending time reading scriptures, spending time in prayer, in silence, so we're listening to God, not just telling Him everything that needs to be fixed? Have a conversation with someone, whether it be a face-to-face, if you're able, or a phone conversation. Have a conversation with somebody. Take a nap. Instead of reading stories that get you so pumped up, take a nap. Can we take some time to believe? Watch a feel-good movie, or for me, it's a documentary. Learn something that has nothing to do with what we're experiencing right now. Get a good night's sleep. Go to bed early and let yourself sleep in. Enjoy activities that give you life, whether that's gardening or working in the yard or photography or music, whatever it is. Enjoy activities that give life. Sometimes I feel like God speaks in a way that is uncomfortable for me, but in a way that goes deeply to what I need. And today I feel this call to take a breath is important for me, is important for us as human beings living in June of 2020. The reason I told the story about Mother Teresa is that what I'm not saying is just stop worrying about it and act like things don't exist. What I am saying is if we want to be the most creative and at our best in solving the problems that we face, we need to rest. We have to intentionally take time with God so that we can understand, how did He create us to work best in the situations that we're facing? If we constantly go and go and go, we're going to do ourselves in. You've probably heard the story about in the old days, Bob and Steve would remember this, when they didn't have chainsaws and they would cut down trees with an axe. And there was a new lumberjack that came into town, and he was strong. And he started, everybody was just standing and watching as he just was going through these trees like crazy. But throughout the day, even though his energy didn't wane, he stopped being as effective. He kept trying harder and harder because he saw these men that he was doing so much better than earlier, now doing so much better than him. He couldn't understand how were they doing it. He was working harder. He was swinging harder. Finally, an old guy pulled him aside. Could have been Steve or Bob, I don't know. They pulled him aside and said, "You know, son, you've got to take time to sharpen the axe. You can't just power through this. You've got to slow down, take a break, sharpen your axe." For us as a people, I think we need to slow down and sharpen our axe. Slow down and spend some time in prayer, asking God what He wants to do in us, what He wants to do through us, asking God how we can be a part of solutions. We need to slow down, take a breath, and live. Let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue in our time together this morning, in our time of worship, allow the Spirit to speak to you. Allow yourself to take a breath. Slow down on consuming the adrenaline. And allow Him to speak deeply the message that we need to hear. God bless.
Oh, Yeah.